They say in the East, when God made time, he made plenty of it. In Hindu culture, not only time, but also life itself goes around in a circle. There is immediate reality as well as that of the poetic whole. In contrast, in the West, time is expensive. Time is truly money. It is limited and comes to an end. Ever since being proposed by John of Patmos, the apocalypse has been considered imminent in the Western world. The eschaton, the period within which the end of the world emerges, is imagined as a way of making sense of the present. In this event, everything we think is true and real is about to disappear, replaced entirely by a new world. It seems the Indian metaphysical culture did not need a resolution of time, an end of time, a redemption. Comfortable with the thought of time never ending, of time as an illusion, as self as illusion, that meaning was not elsewhere, in some other dimension, but readily available to all, that we are all part of a unitary consciousness. There is the idea of consciousness just like us, who wants to know itself in us and in the stars and its billions of years of becoming. In this sense, there are no alien worlds. In the 1970s, the neuroscientist and psychoanalyst John Lilly became convinced that ketamine enabled communication with extraterrestrials. Lilly conceptualized an idea he called ECHO, the Earth Coincidence Control Office, an extraterrestrial cosmic agency, one of God's field offices, responsible for programming long-term coincidences. That is history on planet Earth. Now, it's important to note that such ideas are not limited to post-1960s drug cultures. In 1799, the British chemist Humphrey Davy became convinced that nitrous oxide gave him access to higher intelligences, wholly independent of human beings, where he would trek through space and receive the ministrations of a higher intelligence that he referred to as the genius. Research into the effects of the powerful hallucinogen DMT, which we've spoken about, reveals striking similarities between reports of those who had taken the drug and those who claim to have been abducted by aliens. Some research has posited the thesis that abduction experiences might simply be the result of a spontaneous release of naturally occurring DMT in the human brain, which in some cases has led to the confluence of ufology and psychedelic research. In secular societies, largely bereft of the mythic resources of the past, UFOs replace traditional deities as the agents of salvation. They are archetypes that have always expressed order, deliverance, salvation, and wholeness. For Carl Jung, flying saucers are mandalas. The saucer is from another planet, the unconscious, and is inhabited by aliens, other archetypes. The UFO was a projection of archetypal psychic contents from the collective unconscious, with the UFOs representing the human aspiration for wholeness. One of the things that mystic experiences have told us from yogis, saints, and psychonauts is of this desire for wholeness. And central to this wholeness is the loss of the worry, the sense that all is ultimately well with one. The peace, the harmony, the willingness to be, even though the outer conditions should remain the same. The UFO, like Krishna, like Jesus, was an agent of redemptive gnosis from the unconscious mind. So during altered states of consciousness, psychonauts and mystics, like the petitioners, were in search of states of insight into the depths of truth unplumbed by discursive intelligence, all this gibberish that I'm telling you about. And receiving visitors from another dimension, right here, right now, one quanta away, there is a universe of active intelligence that is for the West thought of as transhuman, hyperdimensional, and extremely alien. A gateway to the intergalactic communication network, a close encounter enabling access to a redemptive alien gnosis in times of crisis. For Yogananda, if only we could open our eyes or simply close them and be silent for a moment. Yogananda and the mushroom teacher's message to our species, like any yogi would tell us, is nothing more than treating everyone and all things with respect and compassion. And with this, we would enter into a new era of human maturity and wisdom.